Kare tabanyana tusa tawa, halakhe lama mela hanta temu hulu wa Good evening and welcome. My name is Bernie Schlager and I serve as Executive Director of CLGS, the Center for LGBTQ and Gender Studies in Religion here at Pacific School of Religion in Berkeley, California. I would like to welcome you this evening or tonight to the 14th annual CLGS John E. Boswell Lecture with Lama Rod Owens, who will be speaking on Love and Rage, the Path to Liberation. Welcome, Lama Rod. We are honored by your presence among us, especially as the center here at Pacific School of Religion celebrates our 20th anniversary this year. I would also like to make mention and thank the Institute of Buddhist Studies here at the Graduate Theological Union, and also Breadloaf Mountain Zen Community in Middlebury, Vermont, both of these organizations for their collaboration and co-sponsorship of this event. Before we more fully introduce our speaker this evening, I would like to first introduce our tech support person for tonight, Emily Cardiff, followed by PSR's president, the Reverend Dr. David Vasquez Levy.
Hello, my name is Emily, and I am delighted to be assisting with today's event as technical lead. You'll see that we have the chat open, and we are welcoming everybody who is present today to engage with the material and with our speakers. So you can do that by chatting with the two sections saying panelists and attendees. So if you want to message and speak with your fellow attendees and panelists, please use the two panelists and attendees function. There will be time at the end for questions for Lama Rod Owens. So if you have any particular questions about the lecture this evening, we ask that you use the Q&A function. And you can find that at the very bottom. It's two word bubbles and it says Q&A. So please use that to type in your questions for the speakers and they'll be addressed at the end. So without further ado, I will pass it on to our president of Pacific School of Religion, President David Vasquez Levy.
Thank you very much, Emily, for welcoming us all and Dr. Schlager as well. It is a delight to welcome tonight Lama Rod Owens to this lecture. We are grateful for the topic and presentation tonight. It was timely when we identified it, but it could not be any more timely than it is this week, this night. We are have been living in the middle of a year of pandemic, protest, and polarization that in many ways has felt apocalyptic in the way that our faith communities understand often that word, which is a word about revelation. It has revealed the deep brokenness and inequalities of our lives. And that inequality is captured in those whose names we say, George Floyd, Downer, Wright, and tonight, Adam Toledo in Chicago, a 13-year-old killed by police. We are indeed experiencing a time that is calling so much on us to ensure that there are ways we tend to the sacredness of life and humanity, to turn to the things that are truly essential. This apocalyptic time is challenging many of us. And its revelation, it has also in the midst of it revealed the strength of our communities. In this time of spring, as we gather and the whole world is turning, we feel the turning also of new life coming into the streets of our communities, calling for action and for justice in an emerging generation of people of color who call for a different way. That is at the core of the work of Pacific School of Religion, and it has been since our founding in 1866. This commitment to preparing a spiritually rooted group of folks who know that the world can be different and have the skills and the vision to bring it about has also been at the core of our work for 20 years with the Center for LGBTQ and Gender Studies and Religion, CLGS, in this 20th anniversary year. So we are grateful for your being with us, because it is important that we be in community in this time that demands so much of us. And we are grateful to have Lama Rod Owens with us to share and to think with us, to be together in solidarity. I turn it back to Dr. Bernie Schlager, the Executive Director of CLGS. Thank you.
Thank you so much, President Vasquez Levy. And before my colleague, Grace Gilliam, introduces Lama Rod Owens more fully, I would like to say just a few words about this CLGS Johnny Boswell Lecture, which is an endowed lectureship established at the center in 2007 with the aim of bringing leading scholars in religion, spirituality, gender, and sexuality studies to Pacific School of Religion to our campus each spring. What inspired us here at CLGS to name our annual spring lecture series after Professor Boswell was in great part his willingness to take risks in his own scholarship and face those who criticized or even dismissed his work, largely because he chose to write about something that many at the time believed was best left not discussed, something best left in the closet, that is the history of queer peoples, communities, and religion and spirituality. Over the years, we have welcomed scholars, religious and spiritual leaders, change-making activists and artists to this lectureship. And what has characterized each Boswell lecturer is their commitment to take risks in their own religious leadership, scholarship, and activism to help shape a world that, in the words of our mission statement, advances the well-being of lesbian, gay, bisexual, queer, and transgender people, and transform faith and spiritual communities and our wider societies by taking a leading role in shaping a new public discourse on religion, gender identity, and sexuality through education, research, community building, and advocacy. And now I'm proud to welcome my friend and colleague, Grace Gilliam, who serves as Associate Director of Community Engaged Learning here at Pacific School of Religion, and who will introduce more fully and finally our 14th John Boswell lecturer, Lama Rod Owens. Thank you, Grace.
Welcome, everyone. Considered one of the leaders of the next generation of Dharma teachers, Lama Rod Owens has a blend of formal Buddhist training and life experience that gives him a unique ability to understand, relate, and engage with those around him in a way that is spacious and sincere. His gentle, laid-back demeanor and willingness to bear his heart and soul make others want to do the same. Lama Rod was officially recognized by the Kagyu School of Tibetan Buddhism after receiving his teaching authorization from his root teacher, the Venerable Lama Norlha Rinpoche, when he completed the traditional 3-year silent retreat program at Kagyu Thubten Chöling Monastery outside of New York City. It was during this time that he dealt with years of past pain and trauma and found forgiveness and compassion for himself. He views this as a critical step before one is able to help others. Since coming out of retreat, Lama Rod has completed his Master of Divinity degree at Harvard Divinity School. He also practices, studies, and teaches secular mindfulness and is a teacher with Inward Bound Mindfulness Education, where he is also a faculty member for the organization's teacher training program. Lama Rod is deeply engaged in social change activism and is co-author with Reverend Angel Kyoto Williams and Jasmine Saidula of the book Radical Dharma, Talking Race, Love, and Liberation. Lama Rod is also the author of Love and Rage, The Path of Liberation Through Anger. And he has published articles in Buddha Dharma, Lion's Roar, Tricycle, and the Harvard Divinity Bulletin, and offers talks, retreats, and workshops in more than 7 countries. The Center for LGBTQ and Gender Studies and Religion at Pacific School of Religion is honored to welcome Lama Rod Owens as our 14th annual John E. Boswell Lecture.
Okay. Thank you so much, everyone, for this incredible invite and welcome to everyone entering this space tonight. It is such a privilege to be invited here to share and to hold space during this very challenging period for many of us. So again, my name is Lama Rod. I use he, him pronouns. I am currently living and practicing and teaching on the lands, the ancestral lands of the Muscogee, Cherokee, and Creek people here in a city that is called Atlanta, Georgia. This is my ancestral land, the land of my enslaved ancestors, as well as my indigenous ancestors. And as I began to enter into this dialogue with myself, with you, you know, with this expression of liberatory dharma and rhetoric, I call in really the support of the earth, the land, to be present with me. And I invite you, you know, even now, as we begin to just turn your attention and just touch the land, the ground, the earth that you're sitting on, that you're living on right now, that you're working on. And just touching the earth, acknowledging the earth, acknowledging the deep care and nurturing that the earth is always laboring to offer us. And as we touch the earth, we remember all the stewards of the earth, both the embodied physical stewards of living creatures, and also the disembodied, the unembodied caretakers of the earth. So just acknowledging the land, and as we acknowledge the land, also asking the earth, the land, to please rise to hold us. To please rise and to catch us. When we feel as if we struggle to stand on our own. So this is indeed a time of apocalypse. And as we just learned, that apocalypse is unveiling. It is the pulling back of the curtains, of the veil. And we're being asked to be in relationship to what is being unveiled. And often what is being unveiled is the actuality of things. It is the truth of things. And what makes this such a struggle, what makes this so difficult of a process, is that many of us struggle to be in relationship to the truth because we have been wandering through and cycling through a narrative that for many of us we've constructed, because that narrative feels a lot better than the truth of things. Apocalypse isn't inherently bad. It's not inherently a negative thing, but our struggle to be in relationship to what the apocalypse reveals is where the suffering emerges, the struggle. So again, as I enter into the space with you, I also have to really honor and acknowledge the blessings of apocalypse. Even if the apocalypse feels like hell, there is a gratitude that is owed to the apocalypse. Because as the apocalypse unveils the truth of things, that unveiling is an act of love, of deep, transformative, liberatory love. And the expression of love doesn't always feel good. The expression of love isn't always a walk in the park or a parade, you know? And many of us are queer, so we enjoy a good parade. You know, but love isn't always a parade. Love can take us to really depressing places, really difficult places, really dark places. Because real love, and I define real love as a deep liberatory wish for everyone, all beings, to be free, to be safe, and to be happy. That deep, authentic expression of love means that to deeply accept that, to deeply embody that truth of love, we have to do the work to let go of the shit that we no longer need. We have to do the labor to let go of the identities, the loyalties, the liabilities, you know, that we hold in our experience. We have to learn to let go of anything that doesn't get me to the truth, to the most basic, essential expression of all phenomena. Of course, this is a Buddhist view. Whatever doesn't get me to the truth, I have to let go of it. I have to offer it up. Love is a calling to offer up, to let go of the things that no longer serve us in our work to get free. But so many of us have been so deeply hurt by love. So when I speak of love, many of you say, well, I have been hurt by love. I have been terrorized by love. There have been people in my life who have professed deep love for me on one hand, and then on the other hand, they've used that hand to hurt me. And then we ask ourselves, why? Why do I need to trust love? I think one of the things that I realized early on in my practice as I was beginning to meditate and to learn about Buddhism, one of the early things that I realized is that I have been deeply traumatized by conditional love. This conditional love that says that I cannot get the love, the safety, the freedom, the happiness that I deserve unless I fulfill the needs, the expectations of others. I can't get the comfort that I need or the resources that I need unless I make someone else comfortable. And often that work of fulfilling everyone's needs to get the love that we need often has meant being silent. Of just closing our mouths, walking through space, keeping everything inside. Being so deeply impacted by the fear that if we open our mouths, if we speak, if we attempt to name ourselves, to shape ourselves in the most authentic liberatory way, if we do any of that, we won't get the things that we need to be well. I consider conditional love an act of terrorism, of psychological terrorism, of spiritual terrorism. And that kind of psychological terrorism has killed many of us. So when I began to understand this in my practice, I turned my energy into unconditional love and understanding what that was and what that meant, how to embody that and how to offer that to everyone. Not just the people I already loved and cared about, are liked, but to people I've never even met before, to strangers, to people I pass on the sidewalk or I see on the bus or the train, to offer unconditional love just because everyone deserves it. That I can want you to be free and happy and safe and to name yourself in accordance with your deepest truth. That I can wish for all of that, and I don't even have to know you. And I wish for all that for you because I want that for myself. And even further, authentic, unconditional love calls us into a deep intimacy, a deep proximity with all beings. That I begin to see myself in you. I begin to see my same wish to avoid violence and to be happy and to have the resources I need. I begin to see that same wish in you. Regardless of who you are, I see that wish, I respond to that wish. You're just like me. You want to be free. It draws us closer to one another. And it also draws us closer to the people that maybe have hurt us the worst, the most. That eventually our goal in this expression of love means that at some point we have to want even the people who've hurt us or the people who have hurt others to be free from violence and harm. And maybe if they felt free or experienced freedom from self-hate or the self-criticism or the freedom from the trauma that they're habitually avoiding, and in that avoiding creating violence for so many of us, if they could be free from that, if they could experience some level of openness and space and room, maybe if they felt cared for and deeply tended to, maybe they wouldn't hurt people in the way that they hurt people now. Maybe they wouldn't have hurt us in the way that they hurt us. So my expression of love for those that I don't like, perhaps people that I hate, maybe the people who have hurt me the most, this expression of love, this wish for love for them, is a wish, is a dreaming, is an imagining of how they could be if somehow they felt cared for. So when I talk about love in the work, then I'm talking about what to me is this revolutionary expression of ultimate liberation, to be free from everything. And that this embodied aspiration is the cultivation, the highest cultivation of the human spirit and the human mind. Love is the purest, deepest expression of our souls and of our minds. But that deep love, right, has to begin with us, with this one here. And as we move deeper into this period of apocalypse, we must actually call in the love that we need, not just the love that we're generating for ourselves, but we call in the love that countless beings around us are always trying to offer us, to intentionally call this in. So as we continue this space, I invite you just to take a few moments to reflect on all the beings who love you, family, lovers, friends, pets, animals, spirits, deities, the earth, the elements, our ancestors, our lineages, our teachers, mentors, guides, our elders, our shamans, our priests, our clergy people, right? Our ministers, our Dharma teachers, our rabbis, whomever it may be, who are the beings who are loving you? And imagine that they just begin to fill the space around you, and just only the beings who love you. And it may not be a lot of beings, and that's wonderful as well. A few beings, a lot of beings, both are great, because still there's some beings or beings who are loving us, and we can tune in to that love. And we need to call these beings to be with us, because this is a very hard time to be in the world without feeling connected to love right now, connected to a sense of belonging, to a sense of being held and tended to. Continue to call in your beloveds. Let them sit with you. Let them radiate this deep energy of love, or care, or concern, whatever it may feel like for you, allowing that energy to begin to radiate around you. And I want you to be deeply filled and bathed by this energy of care and love around you. Keeping the earth under you. Letting the earth hold you and tend to you and support you as you're being bathed by this love from other beings. And as you are really connecting to this energy of compassion, love, kindness, however it feels for you, I wonder if you can allow your grief to be present right now, to allow your grief to be held by your beloveds around you. Because as I move through my daily grieving, I call on all the beings who love me, including the earth, to hold me as my heart breaks open. As I do this, I am reminding myself that it is okay. That my heart is breaking. My heart is not the only heart that's breaking right now in this moment. When I begin to feel isolated because my grieving is so intense, I remind myself that at this very moment, I am amongst countless beings in this world and all the worlds that are at the same time experiencing the same brokenheartedness. That there is my brokenheartedness, there is the collective brokenheartedness. And that my work of liberation in this moment is first to be held by love, and secondly, to use that love as a refuge that supports me in allowing the grief, the brokenheartedness, the sorrow to be there in my experience. Just to allow it, to let it be there. We mourn and grieve for ourselves, and we grieve for our collective, for our families. We grieve for all the life that we're losing to pandemics, including the coronavirus, all the lives we lost, all the lives that we will lose, all those lives that are connected to our life. Remember and grieve the violence that many of us are experiencing because of just simply who we are in the world, because we are queer or trans, because we are Black or of color, because we are of Asian, Pacific Islander descent. Grieve the violence against bodies that we don't understand, that we can't fathom. We continue to grieve the violence against Black bodies and brown bodies, the loss of life of Adam Toledo and Dante Wright, and all the nameless folks whose narratives and deaths we have no idea about, but we grieve them as well. We grieve the attack, the violence that our transgender community is experiencing right now, the violence that takes the form of legislation, the violence that takes the form of exclusion, erasure, rejection of resources that are vital to well-being, happiness, and living. We grieve the loss of the lives of Black trans women weekly. The loss of life of Dominique Lucius, who died 2 weeks ago, last week actually. We let the earth hold us, we let our beloveds love us, and we just mourn together. And mourn the lives of our ancestors. Mourn the lives of the struggle of many of our ancestors to be well, to be safe. We celebrate the labor that they did to offer us, their descendants, something that we can continue to work with towards liberation. We mourn even the ancestors who maybe participated in violence and systems that they weren't fully conscious of. We mourn that. And as we mourn, we make aspirations and promises to do what our ancestors maybe couldn't do, to commit ourselves to disrupting systems of violence and supremacy and domination. I remember our queer ancestors as well. All those ancestors who died in silence. I remember those ancestors who acted up, who fought, who realized that if they didn't speak up, if they didn't organize and march, if they didn't fight back, then we would not be here today. tonight. There would be no me. There would be maybe not many of you. These are just a few of the beings that we're mourning right now, and that we will continue to mourn. Again, this mourning, this grieving, this acknowledging the hurts. Acknowledging the brokenheartedness. Allowing it to be there, and allowing it to be there, remembering a kind of unbounded, deep, expansive space that holds everything. And allowing our broken hearts to be held in this tremendous space, and how that space gives us the room to respond. To respond and to say, this is what I'm going to do now. To decrease, to reduce, to cut through violence and harm for myself and for others. To stand up, to fight. Not just react to everything, but to respond in a way that's clear and direct and poignant. And skillful, that we may be brokenhearted, but we have the space to turn that brokenheartedness into action, and that action can be surrounded, held by love. And that action is also motivated by the anger, the rage. Because the rage, the anger, protects the broken heart. Because I experience anger, it means that I have been hurt, I've been wounded, that my heart is broken. And I am trying to figure out how to take care of myself. And in trying to figure out how to take care of myself, there was a tension that arises because I really just don't want to feel like this. I don't want to be hurt, but I don't know what to do all the time. And this tension, I began to react to, right? And as I react to this tension, I actually began to express, to move through this energy of anger. And my anger is just as important as the love. Because my anger arises out of a deep truth-telling about the conditions of my own well-being in the moment. I am not well. Something has happened. There's imbalance. There's injustice. There's inequity. There's something happening that has created a hurt. I want to take care of myself, but I don't know how to do that. So I get swept up in the tension that becomes anger. And this anger and this response to anger has created movements, has disrupted systems, has created experiences and expressions that we have embraced as liberatory. From this anger, great change has emerged. And I think anger must always be present, but that anger must always be held by this deep love. That as I am angry with you, or angry with the system, the love helps me to understand that, yes, I am angry at you, you've hurt me, you continue to hurt me, you continue to do things that put my life and the lives of my community at risk, you continue to do this, but you're still this human. And you still deserve to be free, even though it's hard for me to say that, in the moment sometimes with you, at the end of the day, you too deserve to be free. But my anger held by that love, right, means that, yeah, I don't want you to hurt as much as me, but you must still be held accountable for your violence. And this accountability, your violence must be reflected back to you, not in a way that you become a victim of violence, right? When we say reflecting, right, and accountability, it means that you have to see the impact of your actions, your thoughts, your words. You have to see how you have created the harm. And you have to take responsibility for that. My anger demands, my anger when held by love, again, just becomes this mirror that allows you to begin to see the violence that you have been expressing and creating. Because I don't want you to hurt as much as me. I don't want you to hurt as much as my ancestors. I don't want you to be assaulted or lynched. I don't want you to be burned alive. I don't want you to be the victim of police violence. I don't want you, to be erased. I don't want you to be deprogrammed or all this violence. I don't want that for you. I know what that feels like. What I want is less suffering for everyone. That aspiration for less suffering, to reduce suffering, to hold that aspiration is to hold the heart, the very heart, the very essence of what I mean by love and justice together. And that this is a very hard ethic to hold in the midst of our personal and collective traumas. But my almost 20 years of practice on this path has taught me that there can never be the world that I want and need without this ethic of love, holding all the labor of our liberatory struggle. And that I have to love myself enough in order to have the courage to love you. Again, it doesn't mean that I let you do whatever you want to me. That's not what love means. Love means that I disrupt violence through accountability. This authentic love is the fruition of self-agency, of self-power. That when I am rooted within this ethic of love, I find myself in a relationship with you where I'm not trying to dominate you, right? Nor am I interested in you dominating me, but we are empowered together, because power is always happening. Regardless of how much we want to erase power, power will always happen. So let's name the power and understand that when we come into relationship with each other, my relationship isn't to dominate you, your relationship isn't to dominate me, but for us to have a clear sense of what we need in order to be in relationship with one another. And again, we'll never have that clarity of agency without the love. So just taking a moment, just kind of reflect on what has been shared so far. As we would say in the yoga world, we have to integrate, the movement that we've just went through, the learning, the opening, just integrate, just let things settle. So again, remembering the earth under you. Again, asking the earth to rise to catch you. Remembering the seat that you're on, you're sitting on or lying on. Letting that seat hold you. Remembering the weight of your body and gravity. Knowing that the seat, the earth, gravity, all these things are trying to take care of us in this moment. So settling, letting ourselves be held, tended to, taken care of. And if your breath right now is accessible, I invite you just to shift your attention to the breath, just noticing the in-breath and the out-breath. As we breathe deeply in, we feel our lungs, our diaphragm, our chest maybe rise. As we exhale, we feel that lowering, that decompression, the diaphragm and chest. And adding just one more phase of this practice, if you're able to move through this, it's just optional, this is an invitation. As you inhale, imagine that you're inhaling into something that feels just really tough. It feels hard, it feels solid, it feels uncomfortable. As you breathe into that experience, imagine that this in-breath, as this breathe into that experience, begins to dissolve that experience. And as you exhale, you're exhaling out that discomfort out of your general experience, out of your body, out of your mind. With every exhale and release, allowing yourself to be held even more deeply by your seat, by the earth, settling more and more. Allow yourself to be cared for by these supports. Just a few more breaths. And when you're ready, allow yourself to come back to what feels like a typical normal breath for you. I encourage you to remember your bodies as well. Just maybe engaging in some simple movements, some stretching. Just keeping the body awake, active, as we move this energy through our experience. And this is the essence, I would say, the essence of love and rage together. The love and rage is attending to the brokenheartedness, it's an honoring of the anger that arises out of that brokenheartedness. And it is the ways in which we call love to hold this whole process. Because there's no liberation without grief. There's no liberation without the love. And I think at this point in my practice, I believe that there is no liberation without the rage. But again, and always, the love is holding everything. My love reminds me that it's not systems and institutions and evil beings in the form of humans that I am fighting against. It's people. It's people who, like me, just want to be well. Want to know and understand the workings of their own brokenheartedness, but they don't know how to do that. It's just people. These systems are people. These institutions are people. These things, systems and institutions don't exist without people. It's people that want to be in relationship with. It is the relationship that is the root of change. I have to be in relationship to others. I have to be in relationship to myself. And I can't keep letting all of the hurt, all of the pain, all of the trauma, all of the anger continue to distract me from my body, from everything around me. But I have to know everything and be aware of everything that arises, and in that awareness, I begin to respond and to make decisions about how to be in liberatory, changing relationships with people. So we begin to change these ways that we come together and create harm for ourselves and for others. A system and an institution isn't inherently bad, but it's when these systems and institutions do not value and understand and promote liberation of beings, that's when the system and an institution becomes antagonistic. These systems and institutions can be our higher education, institutions. They can be medical institutions. They can be different kinds of schools, there can be different kinds of communities that we're a part of. But when that system isn't about people being free, then that system has to be disrupted. The work can't be done without the love. The love continues to restore our humanity, and it continues to remind us of the humanity of others around us. When people lose their humanity, or in our perspective, when they are no longer human, they become objects. And so we objectify them, and then they become the recipients of all kinds of violence. And I forget that you're just like me, then in that forgetting, I'm given permission to strip you of your agency to be well. There has been such unspeakable violence overwhelming violence. And as I make a commitment to undo or to disrupt the forms of violence I find myself participating in, I also have to mourn everything that I will not be able to change in this life and in this body. And in my personal spiritual practice, when I'm mourning everything that I can't impact, I also offer this deep aspiration for all of us to be free to the source of divine cosmic power. We can call that consciousness God sometimes. Often in my practice, I call that consciousness the mother. We can call it our innate Buddha nature. That we grieve and mourn everything that we can't change. And then we let go and we offer our deepest aspirations of liberation to these higher, profound expressions of consciousness and being. So I'd like to soon start transitioning into questions and answers, but I would like to, before we do that, just read a little passage. This is from, I think maybe someone in this, in our gathering tonight may have known this person, but this is a reading from Carrie Seeline, who passed, who left us last year. She was a student at the Graduate Theological Unit at GTU. And she was a friend of a friend. So this is how I know about her passing. And this friend, this mutual friend sent me something that she had written, which deeply touched me, you know. And this relates directly to the period that we're moving through, this apocalypse, what I consider how this apocalypse is ushering us into a new age of being. So I quote, this is Carrie Seeline. Quote, that the days are becoming indistinguishable from each other is a sign of eternity. The new world isn't that of waiting for the old order to reopen or the old economy to restart. It's to realize that the messianic age begins when we see that the essential labor is to love and feed each other and to revel in the feeling of endless resurrection. When we wake up and have nothing to do that we don't have to do unless we choose it, and choose it in love. End quote. Again, that's Carrie Seeline. I'm just experiencing a lot of gratitude for her prophecy that this new age isn't about things getting back to normal and, you know, going back into the jobs and to the movies and to the restaurants. It's about actually stepping into a new age where we understand that the ethical mandate for us is to feed and love everyone. To feed and love everyone. To enter, to be in this age where we choose to do work, and we choose to do the work that is done in love, not in obligation, but in love. I can be pissed off and mad at anyone, but it has to be held in love. That I must always remember that I love you. I'm also disappointed with you. So, if there are any questions, I would love for us to start exploring any questions that you may have.
Thank you, Lama Rod. There's one question appearing there, and I'm happy to read it. It says, thank you so much. You spoke of apocalypse. My Sangha is reading Time to Stand Up by Thanissara. Please say something about the climate crisis.
Absolutely. Yes, Thanissara is a friend of mine. And she sent me her book as soon as it came out. I actually have it around here somewhere. Yeah. You know, and it's, you know, when we talk about the climate crisis, you know, it's, for me, there's so many roots to the climate crisis. And of course, overconsumption is one of those things, that we overconsume resources. And I think that overconsumption comes from the ways in which we're trying to outpace, outrun the trauma, the hurt. You know, we overconsume not to feel bad. And then, you know, when I also think about the climate instability and climate change, I also think about, particularly and more specifically about trauma, how trauma for many of us creates an expression or experience of disembodiment, you know, or disassociation, which means that we occupy this psychic space outside of our physical bodies because the physical body actually expresses physical sensations that are difficult for us to be in relationship with. So much pain, so much suffering. And when we're disassociated like that, I think it can be quite difficult for us to stay in harmony with the physical earth. When we lose that harmony, that connection or that sensitivity, it's hard for us to sense the instability of the physical world and all phenomenal reality. So much of indigenous studies and indigenous expressions of life is about being in a sustainable relationship to the earth. It's hard to be in a sustainable relationship with the earth when we're not in a sustainable relationship with our body. So yes, this is a time to stand up, you know, but we also have to understand the overwhelming situation we find ourselves in. But there are a great majority of people in the world who are, well, not doing shit, you know? And part of the struggle is to also contemplate, what if? What if we don't get it together? What happens?
No, go ahead. Let me know when you're ready for another question. No rush.
Oh, absolutely. Okay. I'll just say this. This last piece to wrap up this question is that this takes a lot of discernment and skill and practice and wisdom to work through. But a part of our practice has to be contemplating what it means to let go of something that we desperately want to hold on to. That we are in this world, we're in this reality, we're on the ground, we're moving in this world, we have these relationships, but this is just one world that's happening amid countless worlds. Of course, this is, very strict, Buddhist philosophy here, but there are multiple worlds happening, and we can say, based upon, of course, the literature, and also experience for some of us, that we are having experiences across multiple dimensions, multiple realities, that the mind itself is non-linear, which is also to say that the mind just exists. It's not timed, it is not about periods, it just is. There's no present, there's no future, there's no past, it just is, A part of our work is to understand yet that, relatively this is happening, but ultimately this isn't happening. And how do we find a way of living that embraces both of those truths? And this is what we're being confronted with in this apocalyptic moment. So I'll say that and we'll move on to the next question. Thank you.
Thank you. Another question. Can you say a little more about unembodied beings that you suggested near the beginning?
Mm-hmm, absolutely. And my belief system, which is influenced, of course, by Buddhism, more specifically Tantric Buddhism, indigenous practices and beliefs, as well as shamanic practices, which are deeply indigenous. For me, when I say unembodied beings, I mean spirits. Beings that don't have physical bodies, but they're around. Spirits connected to our homes, the land, to the physical environment, deities, gods, goddesses, all assortments of beings that occupy the unseen world, that in my practice, I am always working to be in relationship with. And so when I sit and do practice, I invite all these beings, particularly the beings who want to help, to benefit, to be a part of my practice, as well as my life, and also that includes my ancestors. This is also my ancestor practice. So thank you for that question.
And another one, could you share again the quote related to the potential of a new age from the beginning of your remarks, Carrie, and then question mark, is there a place online to find their writings?
Yeah, well, I'm not sure about the writings. I just have this one quote from Carrie. I'm just thinking about the best way to send this. I wonder what it would be. Well, again, her name is Carrie, so C-A-R-R-I-E, C-line, S-E, A-L-I-N-E. And she was a member, she was a student at the Graduate Theological Union. I think maybe if you just search her name online, that would be a way to find her, especially if you go to the GTU website. There was a memorial there. Last year. So I think Emily has put that link into the chat box. Great, thank you.
And next question. Dear Lama Rod, thank you for your teachings about love, anger, and how to honor and allow ourselves to experience both. As a queer person who has experienced deep spiritual trauma from religion and colonization, your voice and your wisdom are incredibly powerful, healing, and resonant for me. In this time of upheaval, what roles do you think queer and trans people of color can play? And how can our communities best hold space for us?
Absolutely, thank you. That's a really beautiful question. Our role is to speak truth, is to tell the truth. And that's really been all I've been trying to do. Most of my life, but definitely the past 10 years since I've been, a teacher, a spiritual leader, it's just tell the truth. This is what I feel. This is what I see. This is how I'm navigating. Because again, it's the silence, right? Silence. I'm wearing my ACT UP shirt because I've been doing some remembrance practice, for members of our community, who were impacted by the epidemic. This has really been part of my practice this week, but silence equals death, right? Silence equals death. So the best thing for us to do is to speak, right? To use our platforms, to write, to do art, to do whatever we can to talk about what we're seeing and how we're seeing. So we're in this particular position where we find ourselves close to the struggles, the suffering. And traditionally, it is those of us closest to suffering, closest to this feeling of suffering and struggle that speak the most essential truth. How do our communities hold us? Well, we demand the holding, right? Part of the speaking means not begin to communicate what I need. And some of us haven't done that yet. Actually, a lot of us haven't done that. We need to start articulating what we need, but to articulate what we need, but to figure out what we need as well. So many folks in the community don't even know that. Like, what do I need? We have to take time to figure that out. And that's been, again, a lot of my practice is figuring out what I need to be well, to do the work. Because the work for us is emotional labor. It's not just the physical organizing and activism, but it's also this energetic, emotional work of holding space and grounding all the trauma, the disembodied trauma in the world. And we can't do that unless, one, we're getting our needs met, and secondly, we're setting the appropriate boundaries in order to be well to do this work. Of course, love is a part of this as well. We can't let ourselves be consumed by the brokenheartedness and the trauma and the rage. We either get consumed by these things or we're the ones who consume these energies. And I choose to consume the anger. When I say consume the anger, I mean, I just allow it. I just give it space. I give it space by noticing it, experiencing it, and not trying to attach myself to it. I say, there's anger in my experience. There's a trauma. I'm looking at it. I feel it, but I'm not reacting to it. We also have to understand that so much of what we understand as culture in our communities, it's just trauma, So sometimes when I talk about this stuff, people get really activated, because we're so self-identified with the trauma, of oppression that comes from oppression, not just in this life, but it's the trans-historical, familial, ancestral trauma that we've inherited as well, that we will more than likely pass on to our descendants. And so another piece of my work, I promise you, I'm going to end this question pretty soon. Part of my work is disrupting the transference of transhistorical trauma into the experiences of my descendants, right? Into young people, lives of young people around me, into maybe children that I'll have one day or young people that I will be responsible for. So a lot of my work is working really hard now so I can disrupt as much of this trauma as possible. And to create a shield around my descendants that can take care of them and not have them endure so much trauma that they have to struggle with. Thank you. Thank you for your question. I appreciate it.
Another one, Lama. Are there comforting or encouraging words you say to yourself during practice to let your heart know it is safe to break? Mm-hmm.
I tell myself that I'm not alone, and I'm not the only one whose heart is breaking, that this is okay, and my heart is breaking, and that I can survive the heartbreak. I think some of us just don't believe that we can survive a broken heart, you know, but from my grounding, my practicing, you know, the nature of my teaching in Buddhism, for me, my heartbrokenness is just another expression of my mind, and my mind is just an expression of emptiness and space and energy. You know, so this brokenheartedness, which I label and relate to as being difficult and uncomfortable, the nature of that is my mind, which is inherently space and energy. And I keep coming back to that reflection over and over again. You know, that it's okay, that it's okay. I'm not the only one, and that this is just an expression of my mind. And that my brokenheartedness connects me to the lived experiences of countless beings. And in that way, I am grateful for it, because it's actually becoming a teacher for me. And thank you for the question.
And another. How are you able to focus on a certain issue when there are a myriad of issues to look at?
Yeah, well, you'll never be able to focus on all the issues. What we do is develop a liberatory, expansive, I would say abolitionist worldview and ethic, you know, that, yeah, maybe we're not doing work on all the issues, but we have an ethic that we understand that all issues are interrelated. All issues are about suffering and power, the lack of love, violence. You know, so you do that, you know, you understand the root of all issues to be similar, you know, so the interconnectedness. And there will be many issues that I won't ever be able to focus on. There will be many issues I won't ever know enough about. And that's okay. You know, it's easy to get overwhelmed by everything, and that keeps us from actually investing in one thing. We can only really do one thing, maybe a couple of things, but just one thing at a time. And that's the contradiction that we're living in, that is the nature of this particular world system and reality that we're living in. It's just, You have to do this really heartbreaking work of understanding that not everyone's going to be saved. You know? And to be honest, you know, we might be one of those people who will not be saved. Whatever saved means for you as well. That's another talk, actually. It's a whole other thing to get into. But not everyone's going to make it. You know, not everyone's going to make it. You know, our life in this particular, you know, lifetime is not going to, maybe it won't end like every fairy tale ends. You know, maybe everything is not going to be happy ending. You know, that's the complexity of life and living. That's the complexity that we have to bring to being in the world every day. And we have to mourn that. A lot of us struggle to touch into the realness, the actuality, the reality of everything, because we just refuse to let our hearts break. If you don't let your heart break, you'll never come into a balanced relationship with the truth of things. You'll always be running away from it. When you move through the heartbreak and touch into the reality of things, then the activism changes, the organizing changes, your relationship to body changes, your relationship to everyone around you changes, it changes, time changes, the quality of work changes, labor changes, right? Because we realize that the actual reality of things moves at a different speed than our narrative of things does. You know, the way that I think about something is absolutely different than the way something actually is. When you start touching into the way something actually is, then we enter into a new, I guess, a new dimension of the reality. And in this shifting that we're moving through right now, as Carrie, in her quotes, so eloquently and beautifully describes, right? We have to learn to change, to be different. That we're moving into a new world that's going to require a different pedagogy, different methodologies, different ways of thinking. The old age is ended. The old age, the old world is gone. This is the new world. What are we going to do now? And what many of us are going to struggle to understand, well, many of us are struggling with and will continue to struggle with is that we actually have to learn new things. We have to learn new skills for this new world. Like all the old shit that we used to do is no longer appropriate. It's no longer in tune to what's actually happening now. This is new ground, a new world, a new timeline. And soon, I would say as we get into the fall, I think many people are going to start realizing, you know, that they're going to have to learn new ways of being. Okay, thank you for the question.
Another contribution. I struggle with mental health challenges that make loving me challenging and make loving challenging for me. How can I encourage and empower my beloveds to be in communion with me in love through these disorienting symptoms challenges?
Well, thank you so much for that sharing. I think this is something that many of us have struggled with. This is something that I used to struggle with as well. I think on a really basic level, when we're really going through just like these moments, these experiences, it's really about over time developing a trust that no matter what happens, no matter what we feel about ourselves or about others, these beings are around us loving us all the time. There are beings who are always loving us. And no matter how I feel, that's always the truth. I'm always being loved. And in those moments, I come back to this thought, I'm always being loved. Even if I'm feeling unlovable, I am still being loved. There are beings who are trying to love me in this moment. And that can be enough. I can, over time, connect us, keep us connected to some experience of being tended to and loved. Thank you. Thank you for the question.
And here is another one. You spoke of systems of violence only being made up of people. Do you think systems or institutions like that of American mass incarceration can become more evil in a corporate way than the individuals which make them up?
Well, I think that, I mean, it kind of goes into our thinking about groupthink, group thought, right? And, you know, there have been all of these kind of psych social experiments. I'm trying to remember one that I just learned about recently. But yeah, these experiments where, you know, people enter into a system, they may be good people, but they see all this stuff happening And then in a way to experience belonging, it just started assimilating into the system, into the workings of the system. Even if the system may be creating a lot of violence, they just find themselves absorbed in it because they wanted to belong, right? You know, and they begin to think, oh, maybe this is right. You know, the overwhelming power, you know, of group process begins to weigh in and you become a part of it. This is why, you know, we can be in any other organization. Oh, I'll just speak from my experience. Like, I've been a part of communities where I was actually a part of the violence happening in the community. I had no idea, you know, until I left the system, right? And of course, I talk about this in Love and Rage in the book, you know? But yes, when people get together, it's easy for the group thinking process to create even more intense experiences of suffering and violence, as we see in mass incarceration, as we have seen in American slavery and the Holocaust and the internment camps of Asian Americans and the genocide of Indigenous Americans. It wasn't, you know, individually, yeah, maybe some of these people would never have done this, but when you get into a group, into a system and that group identity and group thinking, then we find ourselves capable of a lot of violence. Because we say, well, it's not just me. You know, it's the system. I'm part of the system. It's not me. I'm not evil. The system's evil. In fact, you are a part of that. You know, we all are. We, if you live in America, we're all a part of all kinds of systems, you know, and expressions of oppression. All of us, everyone, in some way. All right. Thank you.
We have two more questions, if we might, Lama Rod. Mm-hmm. Here's one. How do you engage with people who seem determined to divide us? How do you pick your battles? When is silence the best option?
Well, you know what? There are a lot of people who know that the best way to get us is to drain our energy. So there are people who know that you'll bite the hook. You know, and listen, we see it online and social media all the time, right? As well as just in real life. We have to start getting to this point where it's like, there are people who won't ever change, who aren't interested in changing, and we need to get the point. Like, you know, we have to kind of stop crusading to educate and change everyone, because not everyone's gonna do it. So the question is, how do I reinvest my energy into communities and relationships and situations and organizations, whatever, that are really doing the work? You know, I believe that this is the future now. This is always going to be a divide. There are going to be people who are doing the work. There are going to be people who aren't doing the work, right? And over time, you're going to lose the capacity, you know, of those of us who are doing the work. We're going to lose the capacity and the energy and the time and the resources to always try to educate, to change people's minds on the other side. We're going to have to start reinvesting in those of us who are doing the work right now. Thank you for the question.
And watching our time here, we have one final question.
Okay.
And it is, how does one deal with anger regarding injustices when it reaches a point where, instead of being empowering, it overwhelms and pushes away the capacity to remain in a place of loving kindness in one's actions?
Well, you know, the anger, as you know, I think you're aware of this, but as you know, anger isn't the problem. It's our reactivity to anger. So when we talk about it being overwhelming, well, we let it become overwhelming, right? We let it be overwhelming because we haven't, when I see stuff happening in the world, right? And when things happen to me, right? That something intense just happened to me a couple of weeks ago, right? And I had to go through that, that experience, the feelings of something was stolen from me. A deep injustice, right? So when I was going through that experience for myself, my practice was to allow everything to be there, right? Because everything was as an expression of my own mind. And when we also, when we feel overwhelmed, that's also a sign that we're not taking care of ourselves, we're not attending to ourselves, that we haven't created the boundaries to cultivate the space for care and rest. You know, and for me, sometimes, often, actually, I'm in a period right now where, for me, the boundary that I set is that I can't be on the news all the time. I go through periods where I'm reading and watching news most of the day. You know, and I'm in a period where I'm not doing any of that. I do a little bit of reading every day, but I'm not being saturated because I can't. I have to create boundaries to be well. You know. I can't watch the video about Adam with Adam Toledo right now, which is circulating a lot. I can't do that. I can't watch the killing of anyone. You know, even in movies, sometimes I just can't do that anymore. It's not what I'm doing. So there's a boundary that I create, you know, to take care of myself. So I mean, I hope that's helpful there. But when I'm overwhelmed, it's all this shit is consuming me. And I have to remember that I have the agency. I often have the agency to consume these things instead of these things consuming me. All right. Thank you.
Lama Rod, thank you so much. Deep gratitude for your presence among us tonight, your wisdom, your words, reflections, and openness to comments and questions. So thank you again for being our Boswell lecturer this year. And thank you to everyone online. Thank you for joining us. And for those who will watch this in a later iteration, have a good evening, a good night. And thank you for being with us. Check out our website at clgs.org and enjoy the rest of your evening and night. Thank you, Lama.